the Raiders kind of get their season back on track, although I think it's going to be knocked off a track this week down in Miami with the changing of the coach and the new attitude and the new way they're, you know, practicing and how happy the players are. And it's very, you know, very important to keep the players happy. So, you know, maybe this will work for Buffalo. Who knows? Joe Brady is a, you know, he's a consummate coach. He's been around a long time. He can handle things. You know, maybe he can get it through Josh Allen's skull that, you know, stop turning the ball over, trying to be Superman on every play. And just be the player that you are. You're a great player. You don't have to go out there and do it the way you want to do it. And by the way, you know, the way they ended that game, all they did was run the ball down the field in the fourth quarter. Now, we talked about this yesterday with one of our callers. I think it was Cecile. But the point being is that, you know, he's still the leader of the team. There's no question about that. He ends up running it in himself. So they fire the offensive coordinator, and here we go. Now all of that stuff is starting to happen, and all the rumors around Bill Belichick are starting to happen again. They're percolating. They're getting heated. There's all sorts of decision-making that's going to be taking place here over the next 8 weeks. And for the teams like the Giants, not going to be easy. For a team like the Jets, you know, it was a players-only meeting, snapped them out of this offensive funk. They should have probably had it like 3 weeks ago.
Yeah.
But I know the Islanders had a players only meeting out on the West Coast yesterday too.
So players only meetings,
a lot of this stuff going on, man.
Yeah. Well, I did try to find an example of when a team fired an offensive coordinator midseason and it really worked out. Now, I'm sure there's other times that it hasn't worked out because it's a bad team or whatever, but there's one specific example with a team that was a good team that did this, and it worked out in a way that got Joe Flacco a Super Bowl MVP, a championship, a huge contract. So back in 2012, the Baltimore Ravens, who were having a good season, they ended up, but the offense wasn't great, and their defense was very, very good. Cam Cameron was the offensive coordinator. They fired Cam Cameron December 10th, which is obviously later than where we are now with Ken Dorsey. Jim Caldwell, who of course went on to coach the Detroit Colts. Lions and the Colts and everything else. So Jim Caldwell takes over. Boom! Joe Flacco turns into an all-time quarterback for a couple of months and wins the Super Bowl and Super Bowl MVP. So I don't think that's necessarily going to mirror itself with the Ken Dorsey and Joe Brady thing with Josh Allen. But it is sort of similar in the way that you got a quarterback who's performing well, an offense that is underachieving, and a team that feels like they need a little bit of a bump. So there's at least one example of that working in a very big way in NFL history, but it just happens to be, 11 years ago now.
Well, I mean, they do it just to shake things up, and they do it, you know, much like you would fire a coach in season, either for an NBA team or an NHL team or a manager in midseason.
Yeah.
For a Major League Baseball team. I mean, they want to fire some, you know, players up. They want to try to get a different voice. You want somebody calling plays differently. You know, it's kind of interesting because, it's tough. You know, Ken Dorsey, he's been a part of that organization since I think Josh Allen got there. Mm. And I think he was there with Brian Daboll.
He was, yeah.
And, it's got to be a hard thing for him to deal with and wake up yesterday morning to find out that he was going to be let go, especially with the way that he called the end of that game. He ran the ball. They basically, you know, kind of controlled the game. They ate up clock, and the defense had Denver on the ropes but let him off. And that has nothing to do with Dorsey. Now, the one thing we don't know, and I always tell you this, we don't know internally what's going on. We don't know if there's a discussion between the head coach, the general manager, these coordinators about how things are being done and how things are being run. You know, it's interesting. After this happens yesterday, everybody immediately turns their attention to Nathaniel Hackett. And, you know, are they going to change the play caller for the Jets?
No way.
Not
with Aaron Rodgers hanging around.
Time out. He's here to call the plays. That's why he's here.
Yeah, there's no way. Come on.
I mean, you have to execute the plays. And quite frankly, I hope that Garrett Wilson stood up in that meeting yesterday and said, guys, you know, this pass game, the Raider game, this one's on me. I dropped the pass. I threw a pass out of bounds when it could have been a touchdown. I made a lot of mistakes. And quite frankly, if you're going to have a players only meeting, it's not that you're standing up and pointing fingers at your teammate. You should be pointing the finger at yourself.
Yeah, I was listening to Al and Jerry talk about the players-only meeting, and I was shocked at the second name that Jerry threw out there, because Al said, who do you think is running that player meeting? So the first name he says is CJ Mosley, which was actually the first name that I thought of. I totally agree.
I want to say it was only an offensive meeting. I don't know if it was a total team meeting.
All right, so then the one offensive player, the first offensive player that he mentioned that would be running the meeting was Mekhi Becton. And I said, what? So I want to ask Jerry about that. Of all the players that could be running that player's, Mekhi Becton would be the guy you would pick?
I could see CJ Uzama doing it. I don't know if...
Garrett Wilson? I understand it's his second year, but still.
I would also
think,
Aaron Rodgers has got to be involved in that.
Yeah. Mekhi Becton. Of all the guys. The guy's barely been around, for crying out loud. He's missing seasons. He's injured. He's got called out by his team. His freaking coaches hate him. What are you talking about, Mekhi Becton? But yeah, we'll see if that ends up working out. I don't know. I mean, this is desperation stuff. Players only meetings. It happens in baseball when a team loses like five or six in a row, and players only meeting.
Did the Mets ever have a players only meeting, or they just didn't really want to work? Tommy Pham did say they didn't want to work or something like that.
Yeah, he did. So I don't know if they had it last year.
Maybe a players only meeting last year would have been. I think they did have one, actually. By the way, Joe Brady, the new offense coordinator for the Buffalo Bills, this was the guy that came from the Saints who went to LSU.
Yeah.
And Joe Burrow was his quarterback. And Joe Burrow won the Heisman with Joe Brady as his offense coordinator.
Was he down there in Carolina?
I think he got hired in Carolina by Matt Rhule.
Yeah.
Things did not work out. But then again, it's all about who your quarterback is. So Joe Burrow and this guy Brady basically had a great relationship at LSU. And now I'm thinking that you're talking about kind of going with Josh Allen. This could be a good thing for the Bills.
Yeah. And by the way, I don't see players only meeting for the Mets this past year, but Buck Showalter held a closed-door meeting with the Mets.
A closed-door meeting.
After their seventh straight loss.
Let me ask you a
closed-door meeting.
Like, when we have a meeting around here, the door's always closed, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
Why do they describe it as a closed-door meeting?
I don't know, because it sounds more dramatic, doesn't it? Like, Buck Showalter kept everybody out. The media couldn't see. The other people in the organization couldn't see. There's no way that you were going to be a part of this. This is only the team. It just sounds more dramatic.
It
That's
does.
All. I don't know. Closed door meeting. It's a headline right here. It sounds dramatic.
So this whole thing now, I was listening to McMonagle with Yankee Hot Stove this morning a little bit.
Yeah, Chris McMonagle hosts Yankee Hot Stove on the fan from 4 a.m. to 5 a.m.
Right, screaming and yelling about the Yankees. And I guess Marco Belletti got involved, and they were screaming back and forth over each other. Couldn't he understand either one of their point of views. I don't know why. They seem to be very passionate, but they were yelling over each other.
Okay.
And I thought it was very interesting because they were discussing what Brian Cashman said about Giancarlo Stanton, and then Stanton's agent comes out and says, you hurt my client's feelings. Stanton has been here for 6 years.
Yep.
Do you know how many games he's missed? By my calculations, regular
by
season
your
games.
Calculations. So
if I did it right, I think I got it right. How many games he's missed in 6 years?
Oh, boy, it's 6 years.
6 years, Al. I'm going to give everybody a guess. Let Al go first. 6 years, how many games has Giancarlo Stanton missed?
I'm going to say a full season, 162 games.
162 games. Not bad. Eddie.
I'm going to go two full seasons.
Two full seasons. Okay, 320 games.
Sure, okay.
Okay.
Yeah, I was going to go in between there, 285, something like that.
He's missed 423 games.
What? 423?
If my calculations are right, I believe he has, yes. So if you could, you're going to times 6 by 162, right?
Yeah.
And then you're going to look at how many games he's played over that period of time, and he's missed 423 games.
Okay, so that's 972 would be the number.
Right.
And he's missed 423
of
those?
Because the amount of games he's played for the Yankees. Now, I'm
549?
Some of them probably were rest days.
Still.
Let's say 50 rest days in there.
Whatever.
You're still looking at 473.
Yeah.
373.
It's still. The fact that it's over 300 is crazy.
It's over 400.
I mean, well, yes, I know. But I'm saying the fact that it's even over 300, it's over 400 is amazing. Oh, it's over 300 is nuts. But yeah, I mean, I am, I don't blame Brian Cashman at all for saying what he said. I think it's great that he's firing back and this offseason has gotten off to an exciting and interesting start for the Yankees. And I love how the agent comes out and goes, oh, it just shows you that anybody who wants to play for that team has to have the thickest skin in the world to play in that market, because you're not even safe in the offseason. I would consider someone to really think about that if it was a regular player in free agency or an international player, because I believe that he represents that agent, represents Yamamoto, the Japanese pitcher that everybody's going to be clamoring over this offseason. Like, doofus, you need the Yankees involved in these things. You idiot.
Well, of course,
like, you get paid.
First call will be to Brian Cashman. Hey, you want Yamamoto?
Yeah, right.
You know, just so we can get him involved and then get Steve Cohen involved and then get the Dodgers involved and get the Padres involved, who, by the way, unfortunately just lost their owner.
Yeah, I know.
He passed away. So I don't know what the financial situation is with the Padres right now. I don't know if they're going to be unloading players, but a lot of people around baseball do believe, and I know we've talked about this, that Juan Soto is available.
That's right. Yes, you've heard that.
Yeah.
Time and time again. But yeah, I mean, I just...
You know, maybe like I told you the other day when Brian Cashman came out and said all this, I knew that there was going to be some sort of blowback from the Stanton side on it. You just know it. Now, he has a full no trade clause. You know, I don't know.
In the hell, even if he waived that thing, would want that guy? And that's the biggest problem. There's not a single team on earth that would take that load right now. He's worthless. He doesn't play. When he does play, he's not any good. And he's got this albatross of a contract for how many more years? You'd have to be a stone cold moron to take Giancarlo Stanton on your baseball team. Even if you just took him for nothing, you didn't even need to trade anything away. You just took him. It'd be the dumbest thing ever, clogging up your payroll and making you get closer to the luxury tax.
The Yankees and the Marlins ended up paying a lot of the payroll.
What's that?
Even if the Yankees and the Marlins took up a lot of the payroll. Now, the interesting thing, I was reading this contract. Everybody talks about how the Marlins are picking up a portion of the contract.
Yeah.
So, as I read it here, it basically says the Marlins will retain $10 million in each of the seasons 26, 27, and 28.
Okay.
And 28 is a club option.
All right.
So he is heading into 2024. He's got 4 years left on his present deal with the club option coming in year five, 2028. He'll be 34 years old this year. In 2024, and he's making $32 million.
We also need to correct your calculations. Did you factor in that there was only 60 games in the pandemic season? That was 2020.
Oh, you're going to have to figure it out then.
Yeah. All right. So there's...
I was so jacked to say 423. Yeah. So we're going to have to take a big portion.
102.
I don't know how many games that he... I don't know. I don't know how many games he ended up missing in 2020. Do you remember?
I don't. But... if he played all 60 and we're calculating an 162 game season. Right?
Yeah, we can't.
Yeah.
No. All right. So that's why I said my calculations are probably off.
Right. Just needed to. But still, it's a lot of games.
But the point is that he missed a lot of games. Let me get it right.
Okay.
I'm going to give you the amount of games he played in 2020, okay?
All right.
So in 2020, he played 23 games.
Okay.
In 2019, he played 18 games. 2020, he played 23 games.
Okay.
So that's less than half the season.
Yes, it was.
So let's look at it percentage-wise.
Percentage-wise.
Right. Then 139 games, 110, and 101.
All right. And then the year before that, what, 2019?
2018, he was 158 games. 2019, 18 games.
Little 18-game season, like the NFL for Giancarlo Stanton. Oh, baby. Yeah. Well, I mean, the point, we understand that he misses a lot of time.
He's played 549 games for the New York Yankees.
Okay.
I mean, you know, he misses a lot of games. What can I tell you?
Yeah, and Brian Cashman said it, and he's right.
Thanks so much for watching the video. Please like and subscribe. And don't forget to hit the bell so you're notified when we're dropping new content.